Welcome to Catholic Messenger Conversations. Today, we're speaking with Bishop Thomas Zinkula. Bishop, nearly 6 months have passed since COVID-19 disrupted our lives. 2 months after the resumption of public celebration of the Mass, with precautions in place to prevent the spread of the novel coronavirus, we're still negotiating the new normal in our liturgies. So, I'm wondering, can we focus on the celebration of the Mass in our diocese in the midst of this pandemic and what it's like?
That would be wonderful, Barb. I was hoping that you would ask.
Okay. Let's talk about some of the ways that Mass is being celebrated in the parishes. Besides social distancing in the churches and live streaming Masses, what can you tell us about outdoor Masses, use of parking lots, radios, loudspeakers, and overflow space?
So there's a lot of creative things happening out there, I've discovered. And so, you know, like there are parishes that are having parking lot Masses where they're totally out in the parking lot. Maybe people are outside their cars and they bring lawn chairs, or they go through the AM radio, and so they can just be in, they can listen, be in their cars listening to the Mass on the radio, or they have loudspeakers, you know, maybe if they're, you know, just kind of outside their cars. They could do live stream too. You know, sometimes when people, they're doing live stream in the church, regular mass in the church, live stream, and then they listen to their car, and then they either come in for communion or communion ministers go out to them.
Wow.
So there's that, those kinds of things.
Are there a lot of parishes doing that, do you think?
Yeah, there's the Riverside, Richmond, Wellman cluster is doing that. They have a truck, you know, the bed of a a trailer or something that they set up on top. So they do it, I think, every weekend. And DeWitt has outdoor Masses, a parking lot. Thomas More in Coralville, they're outside. Keokuk has maybe one Mass that's outside, maybe inside and outside at the same time. So those are the ones that come to mind. Yeah, and so like I was at St. Anthony's a couple weekends ago, and they sort of pulled all together. They live stream one of their Masses, but otherwise the other ones, they have the indoor social distance situation.
Right.
Then they have people in a couple different, like a parish center, a couple different places inside, and then outside as well. And they have a loudspeaker set up out there, so you get any one thing you want. So I went one of the Masses, I went outside to distribute communion and to see what that was like. And there's people, they got their spots where they're comfortable.
Wow.
There's a woman came out of her car. She's in her car, it's parked on this side of the street, but probably, you know, the door open, she could hear, or the window open, she could hear. So they're just kind of all wherever they are out there. And so whatever works for people. It's really interesting what they're doing.
So have you celebrated Mass yourself outside then in any of the parishes?
No, I will. Not this weekend, but next weekend I'm going to be subbing at DeWitt, so I'll experience that there.
So they actually do the Mass outdoors then?
Yeah, they're outside.
Okay.
Yeah. I mean, they could be both, mostly they're just outside and just do it out there. So the weather's decent, you know.
Kind of like the drive-in theater in a way.
Kind of, yeah.
I don't know. Where are things at with the wearing of face masks during Mass?
Well, I don't know if you're aware of this, but that's sort of controversial these days.
You know? My gosh.
So
no,
it's
kidding.
The same thing in the church. I don't know. You know, in terms of priests, presiders, they do different things. They're all wearing a mask when they distribute communion, when they're near people.
Right.
You know, we've suggested, hopefully, that they're doing this, that when they're processing in and out, if they're not coming out of the sacristy, but they're going through down the aisle, they're close to people then to wear a mask. In the sanctuary, you know, some of them wear a mask the whole time. Others will, you know, take off their mask, or won't wear a mask when they're in the sanctuary if it's a ways away. Others will, you know, wear a mask mostly, but not when they're preaching or proclaiming the gospel. At the altar, I'm not sure what they're doing. What I do at the altar, I always wear a mask there because, you know, there's the wine you don't have to worry about because that's just priest consuming, but when it becomes the blood of Christ, but with the hosts, we're going to be distributing those. So even you can put a paten or, corporal, you know, over or something over a the hosts.
Uh-huh.
But still, I usually wear a mask at the altar because, you're speaking and right over those hosts and things.
Oh, that's a good point.
Or to have a covering on the on the ciborium or whatever. Anyway, that's what I do.
About people wearing masks?
Yeah, so
in the
people,
pews?
It's a mixed bag. You know, we've really strongly encouraged people to wear masks, and we haven't said we're gonna kick you out if you don't, throw you out. You know,
yeah.
But some pastors, I think they pretty much are sort of mandating it, and you know, on their own. That's fine if they want to do that. But it becomes sort of it's like everybody does it or kind of nobody does a thing. I think if the pastor pushes it,
right,
and really encourages it, mostly, you know, people will go along with that. And then this is just what we do.
Right.
But if not, then there's a critical mass that just doesn't want to wear masks, and then other people kind of join them. But there are some who just won't.
I know of a woman, she was at my parish, and I said, I haven't ever seen you here before, and she told me what parish she belonged to, and she said, at my parish, masks are optional, and she said, I can't take that risk, so she's going to different parishes. I wonder how much of that is happening.
Yeah, I know, hopefully not very much, because once you leave it optional, then that says something different than we really strongly encourage you to wear a mask.
Right.
Not for your own, not only for your own sake, but for everybody's sake, you know, whatever. But
it is a little confusing. I mean, to see people at all the masses I've been to, people have all been wearing masks.
Yeah, I think mostly they are. Yeah, people are good about it.
And so, do parishes supply the masks, or are people pretty good about?
I think people mostly are by now bringing them, but we've encouraged parishes to have masks available. At least early on, you know, people would forget. So I don't think that it's as big of a deal now since people are kind of used to that.
Right. And how do you think parishes are dealing with sanitation issues? Do you think they have enough supplies or enough volunteers to assist with cleanup? I've been reading a little bit where parishes are saying, help, we need help.
Yeah, what I've heard about that is, that's one reason, that's the main reason why one reason anyway, a significant reason why DeWitt has theirs outside, because they can't clean the pews because they're not, you know, evidently varnished appropriately or whatever. So they actually are going to be working on that because the weather's going to be getting colder. And
right.
But right now they can't clean the pews. So that's, besides just the risk and older people and all that, that's a significant thing for them, for, you know, why they have masks outside. But otherwise, yeah, no, I mean, there's one parish I was at recently, they were saying they're going to have to re-varnish their pews because
the varnish
is getting worn off, you know. And another pastor was saying he's kind of more of a rural area. And we're saying that, you should probably wait a little while after Mass so that the virus particles and droplets
right.
have a chance to settle. It takes a while, you know,
right.
so to clean them all up, and there's stuff in the air that comes down on them afterwards, it doesn't make sense. So they were having a little trouble getting people to stay like for an hour after Mass to
I remember when I was like a kid, and some, you know, in some people's houses they would put like bed sheets over their couch,
yeah,
you know,
right,
to keep it clean or whatever. I said to someone jokingly, I said, what if you just did that and the parish would just put, you know, sheets over the pews that you want people to sit in, and then they could clean the sheets afterwards. And they said, well, that isn't a very good
idea.
Easier
to, yeah, right. So, no, people, what I've seen is people, they're dedicated. You know, this is their job. They do it. I see them going around, and it takes some time and effort.
I wonder, though, too, we're noticing, like, sometimes a shortage of sanitizing wipes, disinfectant wipes.
Yeah, I haven't heard that.
Okay.
But I haven't heard that. It could be, but I haven't heard that.
So then they might get us back into recycling, huh? I think a lot of washing.
Right.
What are you hearing from people in the pews or watching from their sofas at home about no music during Mass?
Oh, I've heard from them. I had meetings with the deaneries last week. A couple days I met with the different deaneries, and that came up in terms of people asking about music. And I've heard that from musicians. That this is my gig, you know, and I can't do this. And so, yeah, there's people that are wanting us to relax that. The problem with that is, you know, there are studies that show, you know, that when you sing, I mean, you're really projecting, and
right.
and so the virus is, you're putting out more virus, and, you know, and And even if the people will say, well, yeah, but we're a long ways away or, you know, whatever, but still. And then they're kind of wanting to use canters. How about the canter? Just one person, you know, with a mask. And,
right.
But the thing about that is that's not the role of canters to sing for us.
They're, right. Yeah.
They're not
good
soloists.
Point.
So we'd be going backwards, you know, and you know, they're to lead them singing. So that's not an ideal. And also, once a cantor is singing and it's a song people like, people might just join in because this is what you do, you know, which is what you want them to do, but not now, because that'd be more people, you know, spewing out virus and out amongst.
Well, some parishes are doing like instrumental music. They're
yeah,
playing.
Right. There's some doing that. Right.
So that's all right, isn't
yeah,
it?
Yeah. There's plenty that they'll do that. They'll do during the procession or communion time or whatever. And part of it with singing too is it adds time to the mass.
Oh, that's
so
right.
So if you like taking a chunk of time to sing, it's one thing to cover, you know, the instrumental music when somebody's walking in or during communion, but it's another thing when you know, and we're trying to keep the mass as short as possible, just because the longer you're together in a group, the more risk.
What about some people who really like to do long homilies?
It's not. They should really learn to cut down their homilies. No, it's not.
Cut
no.
to the chase.
Yeah, really. It's. Yeah. I mean, I've heard a little bit about that. Priests preaching kind of long, but and I have to admit, I need to work on that myself a little bit. You know, but it might even be better if you just kind of cut to the chase and leave out some of this extra stuff that's fluffy, whatever.
Because I've noticed that some parishes, the length of time for a mass, I'm not trying to clock it or anything, but some go pretty much over 30 minutes, but then others are 30 minutes.
No, we're shooting for 30 minutes. I mean, you know, I heard somebody say that they're kind of, it's a small group of people there and it's like 20 minutes. And sometimes there's other, like at St. Anthony's, it took a little while to get around to give communion to all these people.
And, oh, that's, yeah.
And if there's something, like if I'm like installing a pastor or doing something, it just, you know, there's extra time. So, you know.
That's acceptable. Well,
you shoot for 30 and get as close as you can.
Well, if you're doing it outdoors.
Outdoors, it's not as it's not.
So the 30 minutes isn't so crucial.
Not so much. They found that outdoors, you're pretty safe unless you're close in close proximity with people for a long period of time. So if you're socially distanced and you're outdoors, it's not.
Yeah.
And it's not very risky.
A musician told me that she tries not to play familiar instrumental music because she's afraid people will sing along.
Yeah,
I think that's crazy.
Oh, I don't know. Yeah. I don't know.
What do you think?
No, I mean, we don't want people singing, so.
That's right.
I don't know if people would sing along. It depends on the parish, it depends on the song and
yeah.
Whatever.
Okay. So do you see any of that changing anytime soon?
Not anytime soon. We're talking about it because we hear about it, so we'll probably put something out to the, you know, to the parishes and just explaining that a little bit since we've been hearing about it and just give our rationale and whatever.
Okay.
But I don't see, I mean, things are not going well right now. It's uncontrollable spread in Iowa, so it would be silly kind of to, you know,
right.
to loosen things up.
And
but in our next stage, I think we talk about the possibility of a canter, and we do open it up, you know, if we ever can get this thing under control.
I'm wondering, there isn't, with the COVID-19 kind of escalating here in Iowa, is there a possibility that we might go back a step?
There's always that possibility. If it really gets spikes, then that's one thing. But I'm not looking at that like anytime soon. I mean, the thing I've been hearing, we have all these precautions. We're probably more strict than a lot of dioceses.
Right.
And people are saying, and we've got older people coming, even though maybe they shouldn't, you know, whatever.
Right.
But people are saying they feel more comfortable at Mass than any place else when they're out in public.
Wow.
So that's, I mean, we're learning. We've learned a lot about this virus, and we didn't know about masks early on, right?
Right.
And we've done these things, and I'm not aware of any outbreak of the virus because of Mass. You know, people coming to Mass. So it seems to be working at this point. But if things really went haywire, that's another story.
Well, you kind of answered my next question, because I was going to ask you, how comfortable do people feel attending Mass in person in comparison to, say, going to the grocery store or a restaurant?
No, I mean, I've heard a lot of people saying that they appreciate the precautions that we put in place and that they do feel comfortable coming to Mass.
Oh, that's
so
great.
Which is, yeah, that's what you want.
I don't think I've been to a restaurant since early March, but
yeah,
I have been going to Mass. Who and who isn't attending Mass, and what's your advice to people regarding their participation in person, especially the most vulnerable who insist on attending? You know, I know people who are in their 70s and 80s,
yep,
maybe higher, who are going to Mass.
I know.
And feel perfectly comfortable being there and need to be there, they believe.
Yeah, they're more into the obligation, you know, than the younger people are. We just welcome them. I mean, you know, we don't encourage, but they're going to do what they're going to do. And okay, but wear a mask and wash your hands and all the social distance, all that stuff. It's a bit concerning that the younger group, younger families and such aren't, they're not around that much. You know, they're there, but they're kind of in some ways more taking more precautions than some are older people.
Is that what it is? Or it's interesting because I have noticed that.
Yeah, no, I don't know if it's that. It's more like maybe this is just a sense of obligation. So they're dispensed and okay, you know, under these circumstances, we don't have to take this risk. We can watch it on the computer or whatever. And we're going to have to work really hard to bring people back whenever that time comes, because people are developing habits. And now's not the right time, but at some point we really need to invite folks back
I wonder what those younger families are doing that they, you know, if they used to come to Mass.
Yeah,
what are they doing instead?
That's a good question. Are they watching on live stream, or maybe they started doing that? Are they still doing that? That's a good question.
And
I don't know.
Yeah, and I'm thinking, it's just been such a long time. I wonder if people are just kind of getting tired of the pandemic, tired of restrictions. I mean,
well, I think
it's just not the same.
Probably. We all probably are tired of it. Yeah, I don't know. It's probably a mixed bag, different things for different folks.
But it is noticeable.
I've heard that from a number of priests, parish priests, that there's not lots of young folks around.
So would there be something we could be doing right now to encourage younger families?
I suppose. I mean, you don't want to make older people feel guilty that
right.
who aren't coming because,
right.
you know, and then we make a big pitch, oh, come. And you know, you younger folks, not you older folks. So, you know, I don't know. Yeah, I don't know. Maybe there's something. We're definitely talking about it and thinking about it. But especially like the younger folks, that it's not as risky. It'd be nice to have more.
Maybe getting them more involved in helping to prepare for Mass or to...
Yeah, I mean, there's not that much to do these days.
No, there isn't. Is it? It's pretty streamlined.
It's right,
right now.
I don't know. Something to think about and talk
something
about.
And that's what your team is doing, right?
Definitely. We talk about these things a lot.
You know, the distribution of the Eucharist has also become an issue. It seems like each parish has a different way of distributing the Eucharist during Mass. What's the best protocol during this time of the pandemic?
So, I mean, there's kind of two main ways that people distribute. They're either the traditional way, people come forward and, you know, and they sanitize their hands in case they, you know, got virus on their hands during the Mass, and they're socially distanced and they come forward and everybody's wearing a mask, the person distributing and the person receiving, and, you know, it's all hunky-dory that way. Or... you know, there's empty pews, so
right.
they just stay in their place. Some parishes think that's safer, just to stay there. And then the ministers of communion bring body of Christ around to people.
Right. That's what's happening in my parish.
Yeah.
But so, I, for some reason, I want to be able to get in line and receive. I'm not sure what, if that's just because it was such a tradition to do that, or...
I think, well, that, and also it's just, there's a reason for that. You're coming to the altar.
Yeah.
You know, like some liturgists that are kind of purist about things, they don't like that. Sometimes you have, say it's a long aisle, they'll have a couple of distributors in front by the altar, and then right. a couple in the back, and they just put it in the middle. There are the liturgists that say that's not good, because they're not, you know, there's just something about coming to the altar. You don't go
right.
all directly to the altar exactly, but you're coming forward towards it. There's something about that, you
right.
know, that we miss out on when, you know, when,
exactly.
when that doesn't happen.
And what about lay people distributing the Eucharist? I don't think that's allowed right now, is it?
Well, it's allowed. I mean, you know, there's ordinary distributors of communion and extraordinary. So
right.
even under normal circumstances, the priests and deacons distribute communion. If,
right.
If you have enough of them, that they're the only ones. But if there's not enough, then there's extraordinary ministers of the Eucharist. So in this situation, we're not distributing from the cup, you know. And so they don't need as many. There's not as many people.
That's a good point.
There's
yeah.
not as many people. So, like at St. Anthony's, it took a few people. Somebody's going outside. Somebody's going to one extra space. Somebody's going to another extra space. And then a couple people in the church. So they had a few people. And there's just one priest. You know, well, there's two
right.
priests. But normally there's just one priest at Mass. And so there were people helping with that.
So some of it's a matter of practicality, right? I mean,
yeah,
and what
right.
and what's going to work for that particular
yeah,
parish.
Yeah, that's part of it, yeah. So there can be Eucharistic ministers, extraordinary ministers, you know, if they need them.
Okay, what about bringing Eucharist to people in nursing homes or people who are homebound?
Yeah, well, I mean, if you can get into a nursing home, you know.
Oh, that's right, you can't get
yeah,
into
you can't
a nursing
get
home.
But homebound... Right now, we've been saying clergy, just limit to clergy. It's their role anyway, you know, and everything. But I did hear a little bit about that at these with these meetings with the deaneries, and we're reevaluating that. Maybe we can, under certain circumstances, if there's a lot of people, you know, and say the priest is older, it's
right.
more risky, you know, or whatever, that, you know, maybe we could have a small group of people. Laity, extraordinary ministers of the Eucharist, who are not at risk in vulnerable categories, who are trained, and kind of make a commitment that they're going to be careful out when they're out in public, so you know, to not mm-hmm. bring the virus to people in their homes.
So it's all about the way they actually physically handle the Eucharist, right? The way they handle the host, I mean, is that
well,
part of it?
No, yeah, well, yeah, but it's also just how they're living their life. Are they
right.
are they careful so they're not going to be getting the virus? If they're going to be going, doing this special ministry,
right.
and then when they go there, if they can, maybe the person has a porch, they can come out in the porch, it's safer. And if they go in, okay, here's what you do. It's not this long time, and you're in there, and you have a mask on, and they have a mask on. And when you give communion, you just close that person just a short time when you give them communion, and you know those kinds of things. Or maybe there's a family member that's already kind of, around that person that mm-hmm. maybe that they could be the person that brings communion. You know, that already happens a lot. People bring communion home to a loved one, so maybe we can kind of make a pitch for that. You know,
right. That's a good idea.
And then train them. So, some of those people are longing for the Eucharist, and if there's a way we can do it that's safe,
right?
We're looking at that.
What any other last final thoughts about what you want to share with people about the liturgy today in the time of coronavirus?
Yeah, I don't know. I mean, another thing besides inviting people back, you know, and when we invite them back, that can be a time to evangelize too. I mean, it can be. You know, not just them, but other people that are maybe taking another look at faith and God, and maybe in a big way. And the bishops of Iowa have talked about this. Maybe we'll even coordinate this for the whole state, you know, let's come back to Mass, and, you know, it's you know, and everything, and people who've kind of gotten used to doing it virtually, and but also other people, you know,
right.
anybody who's kind of on the cusp or thinking about religion a little more because of the virus. So anyway, but then we also need to have really good liturgies then too. I mean, it's dumbed down now. This isn't the best liturgies. So if they come, let's really do it well. You know, let's take advantage of this as an opportunity to really celebrate and do everything we can to make this a wonderful spiritual experience.
And it's all in God's time, right? I mean, we don't, you envision that, but it can't happen until we're...
It can't happen. And then even when it, you know, when is it's not going to be this magical time.
Right.
Where, so say there's a vaccine finally, you know, well, it's going to take a while for people to you know, who's going to be the first ones who can get it and get vaccinated. And then, you know, how long does it take to get to herd immunity? And there's people who won't, you know, the no vac people, mm-hmm. you know, so then, you know, that affects things. So I think it's going to be a slow kind of ramping up. So it's not like, it won't be just all of a sudden, boom, we're done. Everybody, let's come back. You know, that's right. What we think about, but it won't be that way.
Wow.
I don't think.
No. Do you have visions in your head of when that time happens though? Like, hallelujah.
Well, yeah, it'd be nice to have a celebration, you know, when we're kind of, things are back more to what we can used to consider normal, whatever. Yeah. But I think it'll be, you know, be more and more people coming back and over a period of time. And then at some point where it's, you know, it's pretty safe now to be together, then we'll have a big celebration that we made it through this thing.
Awesome. I think that's a great way to end this program, this segment of Catholic Messenger Conversations. Thanks. You'll be back next month, right?
Your wish is my command.
Thank you.
All right.